Father of kindness, you have poured out grace. You brought me out of darkness, you have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, I can't help but say, faithful forever you will be. Faithful you are. All your promises are yes and amen. All your promises are yes and amen. Beautiful Savior, you have brought me near. You pulled me from the ashes, you have broken every curse. Blessed Redeemer, you have set this captive free. Lord, I can't help but sing. All your promises are yes and amen. All your promises are yes and amen. Faithful you are. Faithful forever you will be. Yes and amen. Oh, all your promises are yes and amen. I will rest in your promises, 'cause my confidence is your faithfulness. Oh, I will rest in your promises, 'cause my confidence is your faithfulness. Oh, I will rest in your promises, 'cause my confidence is your faithfulness. Oh, I will promises, 'cause my confidence, oh, is your faithfulness. Oh, I will rest in your promises, 'cause my confidence is your faithfulness. Oh, I will rest in your promises, 'cause my is your faithfulness. Faithful you are. Faithful forever you will be. Faithful you are. Yes, you are. All your promises are yes and amen. Oh, are yes and amen. We believe all your promises are yes and amen. Oh, all your promises are yes and amen.
You are the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory. Promise you made. Let
remember that peace is a promise you keep. Peace is a promise you keep. You will stay true even in the chaos. My mind wreaks havoc. I will be still, for I've known all along. My Jehovah Shalom, there's a peace far beyond all understanding. May it ever set my heart at is a promise you keep. Peace is a promise you
everyone. We just want to welcome you here this morning to Centerpoint Church. We are glad to worship the Lord with you and to learn more about Him as we dig into Revelation 13 with Glenn this morning. Before we head into giving our tithes and offerings, kids, just a reminder that you have Centerpoint Kids at 10:30, so make sure you have your device so you're ready to Zoom. If you're new to us, there is a link below, or you can go to our app and website to find the link for Centerpoint Kids Church. It's gonna be good. Okay, let's head into giving our tithes and offerings. So we can do this four different ways. You can go to our app and give there. You can e-transfer, go to our website to give online, or you can mail your tithes and offerings to the church. All right, let's pray and thank God for these things. Father, we are thankful that we can once again get together and worship you and dig in into your word. And God, I pray that as we give these tithes and offerings, that you would bless them, that you would use them for your kingdom, and God, that you would be honored and glorified through them. God, we look to you as we head into Revelation 13. We pray that you'd give us understanding and hope as we know the end of this story. God, you're good. We look to you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Thank you. few years ago, there was a book that came out very popular. And I was reminded of it because I was talking to my daughter about the best-selling books of all time. And we were looking in the nonfiction, or the fiction category, sorry. And this was, I think, in the top five. It was a book called The Da Vinci Code. I don't know if you remember that book, but it was basically a book about a bunch of conspiracies surrounding the history of the church and how it played out through the last 2,000 years, especially in the Middle Ages, and through a lot of the more established church or the European church. And so that conspiracy was very popular, and it sold millions and millions of copies. We love our conspiracies, don't we? We love to think about all the stuff that's happening behind the scenes. And people that might be a little bit prejudicial towards people of a Christian faith might have read that book and thought that there was a lot of truth based there. And then, of course, for those of us that might have different points of view, we might be more bent to other kinds of conspiracies. As a matter of fact, the term conspiracy theory has become very popular ever since that book was written. As a matter of fact, it's become even more popular probably than it was 10 years ago or so. But the reality is there is a grand conspiracy behind all the evil that we see in the world, because there's a manipulator that is behind all of the evil that's in the world. And while not every single action and not every single activity is a direct result of this person's manipulative control, nevertheless, they're responsible for an awful lot of it. And I think if we look behind the curtain and we see behind the scenes, we'll realize that the conspiracies that we like to fall into or the conspiracies that we like to see probably aren't real, but the bigger one is. And that is Satan himself. Now, in Revelation chapter 12, we just ended in verse 17 last week. And I want to just pick it up and read one verse before we get into Revelation chapter 13. And it's Revelation chapter 12, verse 18. It says this, "Then the dragon took his stand on the shore behind the sea." Beside the sea, Satan is responsible for much of the world's evil. The dragon takes his stand, and this is metaphorical in nature. It's written in that way, but it's representing something, and it's clear in the text what it represents. The dragon, of course, is Satan, and he is summoning what's about to happen next. He's standing on the shore of the sea, and he is calling forth this horrible creature that shows up next. The beast that shows up in chapter 13 is under his authority. He is the one that is used by the opposer of God, Satan. This is the one who is being used by Satan and orchestrating all the events that fall on earth that torment the people of God and enslave the entire population of the planet. Satan is the ultimate manipulator behind everything that we see in this 13th chapter. And he's been doing so for a long period of time, ever since the Garden of Eden, ever since the beginning of humankind's history. And Satan is the one that manipulates the kingdoms of people, kings and queens and all the world empires. And let's pick it up in chapter 13. So there's a beast that rises out of the sea, and it has 7 heads and 10 horns. With 10 crowns on its horns. So we've seen this again. We saw this in chapter 12. We're seeing this here in chapter 13. So now there's a beast. There's a dragon beforehand, same imagery, and now the beast that the dragon summons that has the same kind of imagery. 7 heads, 10 horns, 10 crowns on its horns, and written on each head were names that blasphemed God. This beast looked like a leopard, but it had the feet of a bear and the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave the beast his own power and throne and great authority. Satan here gives this beast his own power, throne, and authority. And I believe as we look at Scripture that we forget so often, but if we look at Scripture, we see that Satan is the one that gives the kingdoms of humankind their power. Satan is the one that gives these kingdoms their power. Look again at chapter 13, verse 2. The dragon gave the beast his own power and throne and great authority. Now, you're wondering, what is this beast anyways? And what is the seven heads and 10 horns and 10 crowns? What is this? 10 horns show up later, 10 crowns. What is this beast? Revelation chapter 17, which we will cover later, goes into more detail. But it tells us that this seven heads of this beast are the kingdoms of humanity, of humankind. Five of those kingdoms had already happened and passed by the time John wrote this apocalypse. The sixth was currently in power, and the seventh was still to come. So as far as we're concerned, because John is 2,000 years removed from us, six of those kingdoms have come and gone, and there's one yet to come in the future. The seven-headed beast represents the seven great world kingdoms that touch Bible prophecy, the ones that were around the nation of Israel and that area where the Bible was concerned and geographically dealing with the people that were there. These were pretty easy to identify, and you can see four of them actually represented in Daniel chapter 7. We look at the ones Babylon, and then, of course, Persia and Greece, and then Rome comes after that, and they're likened unto these animals that we see there, and they're referenced the same way here in this chapter. If we look at the seven great world kingdoms, the two that preceded Babylon, the ones that were powerful before them were Assyria, and that's found in the Bible in plenty of cases and plenty of instances in the historical books, and the one that preceded that was Egypt. So you go Egypt and Assyria, and then Babylon, and then Persia, and then Greece, and then Rome. And then there's a seventh one to come. The kingdom here is a kingdom that is reigning during the time of John. And in Revelation chapter 17, it reminds us that those seven heads also represent seven hills on which a woman sits. Now, the seven hills, very easy to identify for somebody reading it in John's time. They would have known exactly what he was talking about. I found this in the Encyclopedia Britannica. It says this: Rome was the city that was founded on seven hills. So this isn't coming from a religious text. This is coming from Encyclopedia Britannica. It was the original city of Romulus. That was the original name of Rome. And it was built on Palatine Hill. And the other hills are mentioned there. There's a whole bunch of them. And that's the seven. So the evils of Rome were well documented for the people that would be receiving this prophecy. The people would have understood very easily the evils of this empire and this city. As a matter of fact, their entire movement, their entire faith, started with their leader being crucified and tortured to death in a public way, even though he was completely innocent, by this evil Roman Empire. This was an empire that celebrated in the murder of innocent women and men, sometimes even pregnant women being ripped to pieces by lions, and thousands, tens of thousands of people celebrating. It was a much more evil society than we could probably even fathom today. And the person that was behind this evil, the person that was behind Rome, the person that was behind all those other evil empires is the dragon, the one who summons the beast, the one who summons the beast out of the sea of nations where it comes from. And in the Bible, we read about this beast, and it seems fantastical, and it seems mysterious, but the Bible does interpret itself. And even though some aspects of this are hard to understand, this one isn't. This beast is world kingdoms, and eventually the one who leads all the world kingdoms becomes emblematic of the beast himself. And that, of course, is the one who takes control of the entire world at the end. The prince who is to come, it's found in Daniel chapter 9 and Daniel chapter 7. And, of course, we see him mentioned as the Antichrist, the one who is a false Messiah, the one that does the work of Satan. The manipulator that works behind the scenes Satan is the one who has given power to all these kingdoms. God has allowed them to have power, and he's allowed Satan to have his way in those nations. Egypt worshiped false gods. God demonstrated his power against Egypt by bringing Israel out from their midst. And the 10 plagues demonstrated God's judgment on the gods or the demonic forces that Egypt worshiped. Then Assyria came along, and they were known as an even more brutal country and more brutal nation than Egypt ever was. And then Babylon came along, and the things that they did to Israel were beyond horrific, and they were full of immorality and all kinds of horrible sin. And we read about that in the book of Daniel. And then, of course, Persia came along. And if you look at the history of the empire, even the Persian Empire had some horrible things that they did to people. And then the Greeks arrived next, and they desecrated the temple of Jerusalem that was in Jerusalem. And then, of course, the Romans, not much more needs to be said. So all these kingdoms that are mentioned in the Bible, these kingdoms of humankind, these leaders that led them, full of evil and wickedness and sin, and the one behind them, Satan, the one that's manipulating all of it. So you go today and you say, well, what about today? What about the great world empires that have ruled since then? Look at the history of all of these empires. And while some of these empires did some good things, you would be hard-pressed to say that those empires did what God really wanted them to do. These empires, every single one of them, were built on some kind of oppression of a group of people, often millions. Doesn't matter what empire you're talking about, whether it's the modern empires or the ones from history. And the people that are in those empires and that are the beneficiaries of what that empire presents don't see the sin. They don't see the problem. All they see is the good things that were there for them. And they tend to dismiss the injustice. And these empires that have fallen over the years, each one of them has fallen because they've been opposed to God. These empires that are mentioned in chapter 13 of Revelation are being manipulated by the great dragon who stands by the sea and summons it forth. We need to remember that. Last week we looked at Satan being our real enemy, and Satan is also the manipulator. And he definitely should not be underestimated. Satan also gives the kingdoms of humankind false hope. He turns the people of the earth from the truth of God and distracts them with a powerful lie. He says, you don't need God. You can do it all on your own. And Satan even takes the leader of this final kingdom of humankind and miraculously heals him from a fatal wound. And the result of this action is found in chapter 13, verse 3. It says, I saw one of the heads of the beast seemed wounded beyond recovery, but the fatal wound was healed. The whole world marveled at this miracle and gave allegiance to the beast. The whole world marveled at this miracle, and they gave their allegiance to the servant of the dragon, the beast, the false Christ, this world leader who comes and sets himself up against the very things of God. As a result of seeing the real power, people on earth abandon God altogether and put their allegiance squarely in the arena of the devil. Has this happened in history before? Well, certainly it has. Remember when Pharaoh, we talked about the very first kingdom that was mentioned when it talks about those seven great kingdoms. The very first kingdom, we read about it in the book of Exodus. We read about Pharaoh hardening his heart against God, and he wasn't impressed by the first miracles that Moses did, even though they were fantastic miracles. Turning water into blood, for example. They were like, oh, what's the big deal? Our magicians can do the same thing. We read in the New Testament that they had names. Two of those magicians were Jannes and Jambres, and these two were able to perform some of the miracles of God. They were able to do them themselves. You see, there was real satanic power that was being exhibited in the false religion and the magicians of Egypt. They had power for a reason, because Satan was working through the magicians. Satan was working through the priestly class, and the people knew it was real. In North America, we tend to deny the supernatural. We kind of chuckle about it, but we also like to watch our horror flicks. We like to watch our paranormal stuff. We call it paranormal. And I think viscerally, we all understand that there really is something behind all this material world. It's got to be there. We can sense it. We can feel it. And even though we might chuckle at people who we call superstitious, at the end of the day, when we walk into a dark place, when we go into a strange area, we feel it too. Satan is real. And Satan is masquerading as someone else. And Satan is lying to us. And he is manipulating us. And he is enticing us to deny God. Since the beginning of time, people have been seeking any kind of other path other than God's path. And the devil finally gives them what they always wanted. And here, they eventually end up worshiping the devil himself. Verse 4 says, they worship the dragon for giving the beast such power, and they also worship the beast. They end up worshiping the devil. So at the end of the day, they worship the devil. And the devil finally gets what he wants. He finally gets the people of earth to directly acknowledge him and to worship him. He doesn't have to hide behind all the other religions that people have made up. Now they just straight up worship him. It's what he's wanted since the beginning. The great manipulator has manipulated people into the worst kind of idolatry possible, the worship of Satan himself and the one that he sets up, his leader on earth, the Antichrist. Satan also entices the kingdoms of humankind to persecute the people of God. This is exactly what Satan has always done. He's always gone after God's people. Right from the beginning in Genesis chapter 4, he enticed Cain to kill Abel. Abel was a representative of those that followed God, and Cain was a representative of those who rebelled. And even though it was a very simple command, it was a command to bring a blood sacrifice to God, and Cain needed to go to his brother Abel and maybe trade some vegetables or some fruit because he was a farmer, and go to his brother who was a shepherd and say, could I have one of your animals to sacrifice to God? He tried to do it on his own. And when God wouldn't accept his sacrifice, he became exceedingly angry and he murdered his brother. And ever since then, we've seen the persecution of God's people happen. The chilling part of this chapter is the treatment of God's people. It's tough for us as God's children to read. It says in verse 5, then the beast was allowed to speak great blasphemies against God, and he was given authority to do whatever he wanted for 42 months. And verse 6 talks about him blaspheming against God and slandering his name and speaking against heaven. And then verse 7 says, and the beast was allowed to wage war against God's holy people and to conquer them. And he was given authority to rule over every tribe and people and language and nation. It's a global persecution. There's no place to hide. You know, just this past week, I was talking to my wife about where I'd like to live. And of course, I'd love to live in Canada. Canada's a great place to live. But sometimes when you look at the world and you see the most idyllic places, You think to yourself, well, it would be nice to get away from everybody. It would be nice to get to a safe place. Nice to get away from all the problems and all the difficulties and maybe all the fears about what's going to happen with our current pandemic, and we don't know what's going to happen next, and we don't know what the certainty is going to look like. I want to go to a place where everything's better. And so we got on the internet. I was just Googled it really quickly. And guess which country I Googled? The edge of the earth, where everybody's able to get out and do whatever they want right now because there's basically no COVID there. Yes, you know which country I'm talking about, don't you? It's the place of the Lord of the Rings. It's New Zealand. Who wouldn't want to live there? What a beautiful country. Economically, about the same here as in Canada. People speak the same language, a little bit of a different accent, but I think I could learn it. And over there, people are walking the streets, going to restaurants. They're out, and right now, it's the summer, so it's got to be really nice. And it's just so idyllic and gorgeous. It's so beautiful over there. And I think to myself, oh, I'd just love to live in New Zealand, or at least go there to visit. It's just such a long plane ride. We want to escape. We want to get away from it all. We don't want to go through the tough stuff. And yet here we read that there is no place to escape. There's no New Zealand to go to. Every part of the world is going to be under his influence. And for the final half of this 7 years of judgment, this trial on the earth, the beast is going to be given free rein to do whatever he wants against the people of God. And from a human perspective, it will seem like Satan is winning big time. But it only seems that way. Here in Canada, we're facing an increasing pressure because the legislation, the laws, the decisions of our courts are increasingly moving to limit the freedom of Canadians, but in particular those of a normal Christian faith. And there's a couple of litmus tests. The biggest one right now in front of us is the state's view of human sexuality versus the Bible's view. Many people who claim the name of Christ have already acquiesced on that. They've already said, well, you know, maybe the Bible doesn't actually say that, and it's kind of controversial, and we should all just be soft on it. And believe me, I understand that we don't want to be a people that's pointing fingers, condemning, full of anger, and certainly a people that, you know, don't care about people no matter what their condition is. Like, we want to make sure that we as a Church of Jesus Christ represent a holistic gospel to everyone, and that there is nobody that is considered an outcast from God's grace. So we want to make very sure that we understand that. However, in following God's plan and law, in following God's plan for who we as human beings are supposed to be, the Bible's very clear on the subject. It's not hard to understand. And yet, here we are as a church being faced with potential sanctions. And I was at a freedom conference. It was the Freedom, a council for the freedom of religion in Canada. It was a Zoom conference a couple of weeks ago. And it was about 4 or 5 hours long, and we talked about legislation that's before the parliament right now. It's actually called Bill C6. And in the legislation, it's pretty clear, if it's applied a certain way, because it's in the language of the text, that Christians or people that follow a biblical ethic about what God says on human sexuality will be persecuted. And it's probably only a matter of time before a decision comes down if that legislation is passed without being amended. There seems to be a tone-deaf response by the federal government that we have right now. And the reason probably is because they don't have the same set of values that we have. They don't understand what we're talking about, or they don't understand where God's word is coming from on the subject. And so we as Christians have a challenge in front of us. This will be potentially just the tip of an iceberg. It could be other kinds of beliefs that the Bible teaches that could also be next. And we'll have a question in front of us. Are we going to follow God, or are we going to follow what the world says? And unfortunately, some people find themselves waffling. God tells us, look, the future is you're going to get persecuted even worse. The children of God here in the book of Revelation are going to be persecuted really, really badly. And so it's a reminder to us in the now, even if our persecution is slight in comparison, it's a reminder that we are also supposed to stand firm and to stand strong for God no matter what happens. Here, this passage of Scripture gives some tough prophecy about what comes next. In verse 8, it says, all the people who belong to this world worship the beast. And they are the ones whose names are not written in the book of life that belongs to the Lamb who was slaughtered before the world was made. The book of life is, God says, those people who are mine are written in my book of life, and those who are not mine are not written there. This book of life will show up again in Revelation chapter 20 at the final judgment, the great white throne, where everyone, the great, the small, the living and the dead, all are brought before God, and they are judged based on what they've done in the books that are recorded. And if their name isn't written into the Lamb's book of life, they are cast into the lake of fire, which is the second death. That's what the Bible says. That's the biblical teaching. And the biblical teaching on some of these things is very, very difficult for people to absorb, never mind accept. And here in the passage that we're reading this morning, it is referencing that. And then there's this warning, anyone with ears to hear, verse 9, should listen and understand. Anyone who is destined for prison will be taken to prison. Anyone destined to die by the sword will die by the sword. And then it says, and this means that God's holy people must endure persecution patiently and remain faithful. Talk about tough words. Now, this is happening at a point in the future. And we've talked about the Lord coming and taking his bride to be with him. And so while we teach that or we believe that, and I know that there are those who have maybe differences of opinion as to what that exact timing looks like. But as my understanding of this, it is pretty clear that, you know, God's taking us to be with him. It doesn't mean that for those that are here, that are following God in the midst of this trial and testing, that it will be any easier for them. They know that while their time is short, it still means that they're going to have to suffer tremendously. But that lesson that they are to stand firm in the midst of suffering translates to us even in the present day. Because if we don't have to suffer as much as they do, and yet they're called to suffer to the end and to be faithful to the end, then how much more are we supposed to also do the same thing? And we realize that when Satan entices the kingdoms of humankind to persecute the people of God, it should come as no surprise to us. And we should not be angry and enraged. We should not be frightful or chewing our fingernails. We should stand firm and have expected it. And say, irrespective of whether or not I'm going to suffer, I will stand firm for God. Satan is responsible for destroying human freedom. Now, he takes away the freedom of the people of God first, but then he takes away the freedom of everybody next. And at this juncture, another person arrives on the scene. The beast is, of course, the Antichrist, the one that is Satan's right-hand man, as it were, the false Messiah, the one that leads the entire world. But then he has an accomplice. And this one is the beast that comes up out of the earth. And he has two horns like those of a lamb, but he speaks with the voice of a dragon. So he looks on the outside to be nice and genteel, seems to be an acceptable individual on the outside, but the words that come out of his mouth are Satan's words. It's like a deceptive, manipulative kind of individual. This person requires all the earth and its people to worship the first beast whose fatal wound had been healed. And he's able to do astounding miracles, it says, even making fire flash down to earth and from the sky, and while everyone was watching. And with all the miracles he was allowed to perform on behalf of the first beast, he deceived all the people who belonged to this world. He ordered the people to make a great statue of the first beast who was fatally wounded and came back to life. So he's able to deceive the world. Now, it doesn't say that he deceives the children of God, but they're being horrifically persecuted. And for those who are following the things of this world, their deception is complete. We know this person later on as the false prophet. So just like there's a false Messiah, a false Savior, there's also a false prophet. Now look at the counterfeit that happens here with the false Savior. What did our Savior do in order to demonstrate that he has the power over sin and death and hell? The Bible says he died. He was in the grave for 3 days and then he rose from the dead. What a miracle. Satan knows that this miracle can't be repeated, but he does his best to try and counterfeit it. So even though this beast, this man, this leader, this lawless one that comes, is fatally or mortally wounded, he doesn't die, but he's wounded to the point where he's gonna die, and then miraculously, he's saved. And everyone looks at this and goes, oh my goodness, we should follow this guy. Now it's a substandard miracle in comparison to Jesus, but people follow what they want to follow. And the false prophet comes along and shows substandard miracles, makes lightning flash and does some fireworks and pyrotechnics, and it's real, just like with Jannes and Jambres with the Egyptian Pharaoh. They could do some miracles, not on the equivalence of what God can do, but still enough that people would follow them. And this false teacher, this false prophet, who is exceedingly arrogant and prideful, leads the people astray. The spirit of this false prophet and the spirit of this Antichrist, I believe, are alive and well today, because the populace is impressed with the light show, if you will, the show. I don't mean that, you know, we as Christians shouldn't do our best to try and present the gospel. But my goodness, some of the things that we have followed as Christians, some of the people that we've followed as Christians, if we're honest, some of the most popular individuals have been more about, or maybe almost all about, over substance, about what's been said. We've seen it in spades. I was watching a non-Christian talk show person who was talking on the internet, and he has millions of followers, and he was talking about the fall of a Christian leader. And he showed a picture of the leader, and it was a picture that he himself had posted. And it was of himself with very few clothes on, showing off his extremely fit body. And eventually that leader fell sexually. Now, I don't pick on that particular individual because, but for the grace of God, so go I as well. We're not above sinning ourselves, so we don't cast a spurious eye at someone else. But we ask the question, he asked the question, what did they expect, the people that went to his church? What do we expect with the people that we follow? Why do we follow the people that we follow? Celebrity is very powerful. Many people say they don't follow celebrity, and yet the truth of the matter is perhaps even the majority do. Even people who say they don't follow celebrity do. And it may not be that you follow them for the reason that those people follow that person. You might follow for a completely different reason. But celebrity and style over substance. Where's substance found? In your character. Substance is found in your attitude. Substance is found in your source of truth, lived out in your daily life. It's found in God's word being made real in the way you live and how you speak and how you act and what you proclaim. Look again at verses 13 and 14. He did astounding miracles, even making fire flash down to the earth from the sky while everyone was watching. With all the miracles he was allowed to perform on behalf of the first beast, he deceived all the people who belonged to this world. He deceived them all. See, the great manipulator deceives us. Satan has been deceiving from the very first time he interacted with human beings. And deception is a lie that is packaged as a truth. It's a pernicious lie, maybe even in the midst of a lot of good stuff. And the reality of it is that we, as human beings, are easily impressed and easily manipulated by some of these things. You and I know that when it comes to advertising, there is all kinds of subliminal messaging. We think we're free and clear. See, here's the thing that people who really want to move and shake society want us to think. They want to give us the impression that we have made a completely free decision on our own, that we haven't been manipulated or influenced by anybody else, and we have been given this just set of information, and we've made a good, solid decision. But in reality, they've been tweaking it behind the scenes. This really was made present and real to me when I watched a TV show called Brain Games. It was on National Geographic, and the entire show was about, you know, how people are manipulating you and how, you know, even through imagery and through sounds and through smells and lights and all the rest of it, that advertisers in particular can get you to buy their product or their service. And it also affects the political world, and it was pretty astounding. But then at the very end of the show, he asked a question of me. And so we were watching it with my family, and I said, if you could have anything right now to drink, what would you have? And immediately popped into my mind, it's like, I would love a big, tall glass of milk. I don't know why it popped into my head, but I did it. So I said it out loud. I said, I would like a big, tall glass of milk. And this guy, obviously it's taped, right? He doesn't know who I am. He said, did you just say that you wanted a big, tall glass of milk? And we all, in my household, we all went, what? Because we'd all said milk. And he said, let me show you what we've done throughout this entire show. And he showed all the subliminal messages of milk that was on the side of a wall, that was in the corner of a video, that was mentioned in a sign, and it was there throughout the entire 30 minutes. And I thought I was making a completely free will decision about what I was going to drink, and in the end, it was going to be milk all along. Now, those things work maybe 80% of the time, 20% of the time people want coffee or they want something else. But in the end, it does work. People are easily manipulated. The greater the sign, the greater the deception, the more likely people are going to be to follow it. Here, it's so overwhelming that everybody that belongs to this world follows him. And Satan enslaves them even while they think they're free. And that's exactly what Satan loves to do. The great manipulator loves to enslave us even while we think we are free. We take the shackles that we feel around us, we think God's shackling us, and we throw them off, and we choose for ourselves. And meanwhile, Satan is all the while manipulating us into an enslaved state. That's why the church is the canary in the coal mine, so to speak. For society, you say, hey, I don't share your values. I don't even agree with them. I don't like them. And then the church says, well, today it's us. Tomorrow will be you. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, we read about this lawless man that comes and sets himself up in the temple of God as if he is God. But it says before that lawless one is revealed, it says he who restrains him will be taken out of the way. And one of the great important ministries of the church is to restrain evil in the here and now. And that's why we speak against evil, and we speak for truth. We dare not get distracted. The end of the day, when the church's influence is removed, I believe it will be removed, then evil will be able to run its full course. Persecution against anyone who claims the name of Christ at that point, from that point forward, will become just horrifically difficult. The people of God nationally, the nation of Israel, will be persecuted. In the middle of that, they will find out that they have fallen into the worst trap possible. And when we see the manipulation and the deception of Satan on such a grand scale, the only hope that people can have is for Jesus to come and rescue them. Now, finally, it ends with this, and this is one of the harder parts of Scripture because a lot of people have talked about it. It says that he permitted to give life to this statue that he builds, that's in honor of the first beast. And it says that he permits to give life to it so it could speak. And the statue of the beast commanded that anyone refusing to worship it must die. Now, I don't know what this means. I've done research on this. I have no idea what this is. I think this is one of those things that you'll know it when you're there. But for me, from this vantage point, I honestly don't know. So I'm not comfortable saying what I think it is, other than to say it is definitely demonic in its influence. And then it says that the false prophet, this second beast, requires everyone, small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to be given a mark on the right hand or on the forehead. And no one could buy or sell anything without that mark, which was either the name of the beast or the number representing his name. And wisdom is needed here, so let anyone with understanding solve the meaning of the number of the beast, for it is the number of man. His number is 666. Much has been made of this, of course. I don't want to spend a ton of time on this. I don't know exactly what 666 is going to look like. I know it's some kind of mystery, and I know it's going to be something that people will obviously know. It's not going to be given to you, by the way. It's not going to be given to you, and you won't know it. It's going to be given to you, and you'll know full well what you're doing. So this isn't like somebody can inject it in you or mark you with it or do it in your sleep or something like that, okay? This isn't that. This is you're going to make a choice. And they're going to be those who follow God who are going to say, no, I'm not taking the mark of the beast. And they're going to be like, fine, then you're going to starve to death. Then you're going to be persecuted. Then you're not going to have the protection of law or anything, right? You're going to be persecuted. You're going to have to run for your life. And you're going to basically have to try to survive somehow, and most of you will probably die. It's going to be horrible there will be huge consequences of not taking this mark that worships the beast. And it says that there will be people, the ones that belong to this world, they're going to believe anyway, so they're going to take it. Satan wants an identifying marker. And it's interesting, however, whatever this mark looks like, however it is, you know, going to be implemented, and I don't know what it's going to be, it says that it's a substandard number. So remember, the counterfeit of the Antichrist rising from the dead, substandard to Jesus, not even close. The miracles of the false prophet, yeah, flashes of lightning and all the rest of it, but way substandard to what you read God doing in the Old Testament or in the New Testament or even here in the book of Revelation. So substandard stuff. And then even the number itself, 6, or in triple 666, substandard to God's perfect number, which is 7. 777. The best that we can do is substandard to what God can do. All counterfeit, all manipulative, all lies. And in the end, people that follow God will be marked for who they are. They'll be having God's name marked on them, and the people that follow Satan will have what's marked on them. We've talked about this, where it gets to the point where there's only judgment left. There's the people of God, and they stand firm. There's the people that belong to this world, and they put their full allegiance with Satan. And then there's the judgments of God that come in the bold judgments that fall next. And they are awful, and they are terminal. And then Jesus Christ finally returns to this world and judges it, rescues his people, and makes them clean. And sets everything right at the end. This window into the future is hard for us to look at. But at the end of the day, it encourages us and challenges us in the now. Will we be faithful? Will we stand against the lies of Satan? Will we allow ourselves to be manipulated by people, by political movements, by stuff, by lies that you see out there? Or are we going to hold to Christ and his truth? And as Jesus said, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. God's truth is found in his word. And it's found in living his word out in our lives. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 19 gives us this challenge, and I want to leave you with this. But not being manipulated by Satan, but by holding to Christ. It says, keep on doing what is right, and trust your lives to the God who created you, for he will never fail you. Oh yeah, it might feel like the world is going in a terrible direction. It might feel like your life is out of control and you're being maybe persecuted yourself, or you're worried about the future and you don't know what's going to come next. You're worried and concerned and Satan wants to discourage you, but realize Satan is going to lose. Maybe the lies that Satan has been whispering in your ear, you've started to believe. Maybe you've started to believe that God's word isn't trustworthy anymore. Maybe you started to believe that maybe I should look at this in a different way. Maybe you believe that if I just did this, it would make my life easier. But at the end of the day, God's telling us, look, this is the way it's going to end. It's going to end poorly. It's going to end in a way that you're not going to be ready for. And you don't want to be on the side of the world. You want to be on my side at the end. So as we close Revelation chapter 13, tough chapter, but an important chapter, realize that the one who is manipulating us can be stood against, can be revealed for who he is. And as we hold to God's truth and we proclaim God's truth to a world that desperately needs it, we will see people set free from lies, set free from addictions, set free from sin, that they might be able to find hope in Christ. So as we go through the week, and as we head into the rest of this month, I pray that you will be encouraged to do exactly that. God bless you.
All right, Glenn, thanks for sharing with us this morning from Revelation 13. And what a doozy. This is not an easy book to go through, and especially if you're just looking at it in small chunks, it can be overwhelming. But we need to remember that we know the end of the story and we know the victor. And Jesus said in John 10, verse 10, that the thief only comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And we see this, but Jesus said, but I have come to give you life and life to the full. So as you walk out into this, we just remember that Jesus has come to give us life to the full, and we can walk in the knowledge of that he is the victor. And in the end, he wins. and we win because we're His. I hope you have a great week. We will see you next Sunday as we dig into Revelation 14. All right, see you then. Thanks for joining us.